come before you. Lord, we thank you for the opportunity, first and foremost, that we get to come into the house of God. What a privilege it is that we get to be here today, Lord, that we get to come and we get to lift up the name of Jesus. We get to glorify your wonderful name. We don't come into this place for tradition, Lord. We don't come into this place for ritual. God, we come into this place to hear from and to experience you and your goodness and your grace and, Father, your word. And, Lord, we ask that in the name of Jesus, that your Holy Spirit would be our teacher, would counsel us and guide us and lead us and direct us. Show us your word, Lord, as we walk out of this place, that we would plant your word is a seed into our hearts, Lord, that as we walk out of this house tonight, Lord, that we would cultivate and grow and meditate on your word, that we would see fruit in our lives, God, to bear fruit for your kingdom and for your glory. And Lord, we ask that you would speak to each and every person that's in this place. Speak to us on our level, Lord. Witness to us and minister to us tonight as we get into your word. Father, I thank you for the privilege that we have to hear and to receive from your word. What a blessing it is. And God, this blessing we ask upon ourselves and the many blessings that we ask upon our church, Lord, we don't ask just for ourselves, but Lord, across all the churches across the Inland Empire and around the world that are hearing the gospel of Jesus, we ask today that you would bless them. You would speak to them and you would witness to them. Holy Spirit, we ask that you would move upon our brothers and sisters all across this Inland Empire that are preaching and hearing the gospel of Jesus. Lord, churches like Harvest and Sandals, Lord, we thank you for churches like Water of Life and The Way. God, we thank you for Emmanuel Baptist and Crossroads and New Creation. Lord, all the different churches across the Inland Empire, all our denominational brothers and sisters or Calvary chapels around the Inland Empire, Lord, we thank you that you would bless them and speak to them as we ask that you would speak to us. And God, as today, our hearts are broken for the families and the victims of the Inland Regional Center massacre, Lord, we ask that you would speak to them, Lord, that your Holy Spirit would be about them, Lord, that you would comfort them and that you would guide them, Lord, that they would know that your presence is with them all along, Lord, and we thank you for the families of the 14 victims, God, that you would begin to work your grace in their hearts and their lives right now, God, as they're experiencing a new day. Each day is a new day without their loved one, as they're coming into a holiday season now without a loved one. God, I ask that your grace would be upon them, Lord, that you would overshadow them and comfort them and be with them, the families of those who are affected. And Father, we thank you for our law enforcement brothers and sisters that jumped into action and ran towards the problem when everybody else was running away, Lord. And we thank you that you would bless them, keep them safe. Lord, we ask that you would uncover anything that needs to be uncovered. Lord, and we bind any attack against this Inland Empire and its people. And we say in the name of Jesus, no weapon formed against us should prosper. But Lord, we thank you for your grace. We thank you for your presence. We thank you for Jesus, and we ask that you would speak to us tonight in your word, in Jesus' mighty name. We all said, amen. Amen. Well, tonight I want to talk to you a little bit about something. On Wednesday night when we were having our prayer service for the victims of the tragedy on Wednesday, you know, I was sharing a little bit of something that was just happening for me that day, and I said, you know, the moment when the announcement came about the shooting, about the massacre, really, about what happened, I talked about how it really put things into perspective. I remember what I was feeling before the news, and I remember what I was feeling after the news, and how everything kind of changed. Everything in my mindset changed, very much like 9/11 did for the nation. It brought us into perspective. We realized that there were some things that we were missing out on. There were some things that we had stopped focusing on. And today I want to talk a little bit more about that subject, as I've just been mulling it over and just been meditating on it and allowing God to speak to me. I want to speak to you what God has been speaking to me about this thing we talk about, or we call perspective, and looking at that perspective. I was reading a book this week, just so happens, and in this book it was talking about some different things that were going on and some different things about Christianity and certain subjects, and the subject of suffering was the subject that I was reading, and it was right exactly what I was thinking about, right exactly what I was talking about or praying about with God. And I read a story about Steve Jobs. Steve Jobs, the visionary computer founder of Apple, who died at a young age. And Steve Jobs, in his biography by Walter Isaacson was writing about Steve Jobs, and he talks about Steve at the age of 13. At the age of 13, Steve saw a picture of two young children from Africa in the midst of an epidemic of famine. And they were starving to death, and they were dealing with all sorts of different health and illness issues. And the article talked about the children that were dying of famine in Eastern Africa. And Steve was so upset by this that he had gone to his church and he had gone to his local pastor, and he brought the article with him, and he brought the magazine, Time Magazine, which featured the article there. And he asked his pastor, he says, "Does God know everything that's going to happen?" The pastor says, "Yes, God knows." And so he said, "Okay, let me ask you a question." He says, "If I was to lift one of my fingers, would God know which finger I'm going to lift before I do?" The pastor replied, "Yes, Steve, he would. He knows everything." He says, "Okay." And he pulls out the magazine and he says, Does God know what's going to happen to these children in the future? And Steve's pastor at the age of 13 was explaining to him, says, Steve, listen, I know you don't understand right now, but yes, God knows what's going to happen to those children. And Steve announced right then and right there, he says, I cannot and I will not worship a God who knew about what was happening across the world to these children and yet did nothing. And from that moment, at the age of 13, Steve Jobs walked away from his faith. It's recorded in his biography. So many stories around the world, so many stories, especially in our Western culture, of movie stars, of actors, of musicians who grew up in church, who were raised as Christians, or who were raised in church or with their family, with a godly parent or a godly sibling or whatever it might be at the age or in an adult when they begin to start thinking about things. All of a sudden, too many people around America are walking away from God. And you see, the subject of walking away from God is a subject of suffering and despair. Like Steve in his story at the age of 13, suffering is one of, if not the greatest reason, people in America today walk away from their faith in God. And it's a tragedy that something like this happens to us. And in light of what happened on Wednesday, there's all sorts of questions that are being asked. Pastor Dan talked about it this morning. He showed the picture of the Daily Mail article on the cover that said, God isn't fixing this. And all of a sudden, a new trend came out called prayer shaming, where people were backlashing or coming against people that were saying our prayers and our thoughts are to the family and to the victims' families. Saying that your prayers aren't doing anything. Your thoughts aren't changing anything. Stop praying. It's not accomplishing anything. And all of a sudden, a tide was changing in America. And if anything, this isn't new. If anything, it's not like a surprise. But if anything, it is a look into the picture of where we are as a culture today. And ultimately, the problem is we have a perspective issue. We have a perspective issue. See, a perspective is the way we see things, is the way we look at things, is the way that we view things. And when we look at things in a certain perspective or in a certain light or through a certain lens of our lives, it might distort or it might change what things really are. And I believe that we are looking at, across our nation and across the world, a perspective issue. Today I brought my sunglasses, and these are my sunglasses, and you know, I have light colored eyes and I have a real problem in daylight. I have to squint if it's daylight, so no matter what, if I'm outside, I'm always wearing a pair of sunglasses. And sunglasses are great, but you know what they do? They change your perspective. All of a sudden, as soon as I put my sunglasses on, everything begins to change. Why? Because my sunglasses are colored. So now, because of the color of my sunglasses, all the different hues around me begin to change. I have a pair of brown sunglasses, which means everything that's white has a brown tint to it. Everything changes. Even right here, right now, I have a hard time seeing you. Why? Because my glasses are blocking out the light that allows me to look at you and to look at into your eyes, just as it stops you from looking into my eyes. It changes my sight. And so often what happens is we walk around life with glasses of perspective on. Perspective built on experience. Perspective built on what God has done or what hasn't done or what somebody said or what they didn't say, what things have happened to us or things that we've read, what teachers have taught us or what mentors have taught us. And we walk around with our lives and we put on the glasses of our perspective through our experience. But the problem that we are facing in our country today is a problem of perspective. That we are seeing life. We are seeing things. My mom always taught me, Luke, you don't see life as it is. You see life as you are. And we are seeing life through the perspective and through the lens of our experience, through the lens of our hearts and through the lens of our minds, through the lens of our logic. And now all of a sudden these cries that you hear about God isn't fixing this, about prayers aren't working. When a tragedy or when suffering strikes, we begin to ask the question, oh God, how could you let this happen? And that question right there is an insight, is a window into our perspective. It's a valid question. I don't want to demean that question. I don't want to play it down. I don't want to do anything different about that, because it is a valid question of the cry of our hearts. But if anything, that question, as we ask it, as tragedy occurs, as we think about the people that lost their lives on Wednesday, as we think about the tragedies that are going around the world with the Syrian refugees and all the events that are happening in the Middle East right now, or the things that are going on with human trafficking around the world, or the events in North Korea or in South America, whatever it might be, we ask these questions and we see, like young Steve Jobs, the travesties of the world, the sufferings of humanity, and we begin to look at ourselves and we begin to ask, God, how could you let this happen? And a question like that, I believe, is a reasonable and logical question, but the question reveals our perspective. You know, recent statistics show that there's a trending decline of Christianity within America. I think it was a couple of years ago, a Pew Research came out and said, for the very first time in our history, in our time, in modern church or modern American history, the number of people that claim to be Christians is no longer the majority. As a matter of fact, a couple of different researchers that went out a couple of years ago looked at the trends of Christian and church attendance and American church attendance, and they estimate if the trend continues by the year 2025, in 10 years, 15% of Americans will attend church on a regular basis. Because of questions like these, because of perspective, because of looking at hard and unanswered questions, because of hardship, because of suffering, because of despair in our lives, it's the primary argument that atheists have against Christians. How could God see something and not do it? How could I believe in a God that allows something like that to happen? It's a difficult subject. It's a difficult question, and I can't answer the question for each and every person of the tragedies that you've experienced in your life and the sufferings that you've endured through the process of your life. I can't answer that question, but what I can say is we cry out in times of suffering, God, why? God, why don't you do something? But God's response to you and I is, I did. We cry out, God, why don't you do something? He did. He sent Jesus Christ. You see, Jesus is the answer. Jesus is the solution. God is not a God in heaven disconnected from humanity that looks upon us and sees our suffering, sees our despair, that sees our anguish and does nothing about it. The Bible tells us that God did something about our human condition, suffering, by giving to us Jesus Christ. As a matter of fact, the Bible, if you've got your Bibles, go with me, because we'll take a look at a couple of scriptures here. In Romans, the fifth chapter, Romans chapter 5, the Bible tells us, it's a great verse, and there's actually a great section of scripture here in Romans, the fifth chapter. Verse number 8, the Bible says that God demonstrates, He reveals, He shows, He exemplifies by doing something about something. God demonstrates His love for us, that while we were sinners, Christ died for us. In context, what Paul's talking about, he says, you know what? Very rarely in humanity will you find anybody who will lay down their life for somebody else. He says, scarcely somebody will die for a good person. But never will you see somebody who dies for a wretched and a terrible and a seemingly worthless person. But you see, God demonstrated His love for us, humanity, that in our sin, in our shame, in our present human condition of despair and suffering, despite all of these things, God sent His Son, Jesus, to die for us. Why? That we might have a hope, Paul says in the next verses, that we might have a consolation in our salvation, that we can look forward to things to come. Why? Because we have been bought with a price through the blood of Jesus Christ, and no longer are we bound to the past life, but now we have a future in Jesus Christ. Pastor Luke, that sounds like you're diverting the question. Why would these things happen? You know what? We know this. We know that Jesus is the answer. But sometimes if we're honest with ourselves, if I'm honest with myself, when I look at my emotions, when I look at my feelings, when I look at times of crisis in my own life, or when I see something happen that is absolutely a travesty in the world, sometimes even though I know that Jesus came and died for my sins, I think to myself, man, it just doesn't feel like it's enough. God, you could do something about this. God, you could step in, you could intervene, you could stop, yet why don't you do this? And the solution and the answer to that question is that God has a divine purpose. God has a sovereignty. And you see, there is nobody before God. There is nobody after God. There is nobody above God. God is ultimate, and we don't see things in the long-term spectrum. When the Bible says that all things will work out to the good and to the betterment of those who love Him and who are called according to the purpose of God, we must stand and believe that God is true to His word, and that God has a plan, that God has a purpose, and that God has a reason for why it seems like He's not doing something in the world today, because He already has. He gave us Jesus. And you see, the question there is a valid question. Why, if you know what's going on, would you not do something? It's a valid, logical question, but it opens the door to revealing our perspective. Because all of a sudden we begin to ask these questions, and what we're doing is we're opening a door to this thing called doubt. And doubt is this trap. It's a trap door that we don't realize and that we don't recognize. And all of a sudden we begin to question God. God, why would you let that happen? And what we're doing is we're not just questioning God's actions. We're beginning to question God's character. And we begin to doubt God. And the problem is that it's a slippery slope. It's a trap. It's bondage in our lives. That's why the Bible speaks so heavily about not doubting God. James says, if you lack wisdom and you need it, ask God in faith. But he says, if you doubt, you won't get anything. Why? Because you are questioning God's character. And while the question might be valid, and while the question is legitimate as far as logic goes, we don't operate in terms of logic. We operate in terms of faith, knowing God, saying, God, I know you have a plan. God, I'm going to choose to take my glasses off and see things not as I see them, but see things as you see them. The fact that the world cries out, God, we need you. And God cries back to the world, I've done everything I need to by giving to you Jesus Christ. But see, what happens is it shows our perspective. And it shows that somehow, somewhere along the road, in Western Christianity, in our own lives, in my own life, we've gotten a little bit weird on our theology of Jesus Christ. We begin to think that my salvation, that your salvation is a divine insurance policy. That means that because of Jesus, I won't have anything bad happen to me. That I won't have to suffer, that because Jesus calms the storms and because we read about all these different things, that everything's going to be good in my life now because I have Jesus. But then life happens. But then something happens down the road from your house. Then somebody you know or your own self, you begin to witness things, and it begins to fight this mentality that you've carried in your life that everything should be good, and you realize that your perspective is a little bit out of whack because you start asking questions like, why? When all along God says, I've done everything I can by giving Jesus. Everything you need is in Jesus Christ. Everything we need in life is in Jesus Christ. But you see, the thing is that we begin to think, you know what I need? I need shelter. I need security. I need happiness. Why? Because our Constitution, because our Declaration of Independence say that every man has a right to pursue happiness in life. And it's a need. It's a basic essential in my life. And so when happiness is taken away because of sorrow, because of despair, because of suffering, when shelter is taken away because of suffering, when safety and security is taken away, or I seem to have lost it in the moment or in the season of my life, all of a sudden now my mind begins to be racked with questions as to, God, I thought this is the way it should go, but it's not happening. And all of a sudden our perspective becomes illuminated that we ourselves are looking at God. not through how God sees us, not through how God sees the world. We are looking at God on how we think God should be. But you see, there's a problem with that. A problem with that leads us to a place of wrong perspective. You see, a wrong perspective begins to shift the blame. A wrong perspective begins to ask, looks at the things that God is not doing, but the right in the biblical perspective of our lives, of what's going on through the midst of tragedy, through the midst of suffering, through the midst of pain, through the midst of the hardships of life, the right perspective that you and I need to have because of Jesus Christ is to not look at what we think that God is not doing, but to begin to look at what God has done. And He has given to us Jesus Christ. Now, I don't want to spend a lot of time on a soapbox because I know it's tense and I know that everybody's thinking about something, but I just want to say that we as a church, we as a body of believers, we see something happening in our country, the decline of Christianity. And it's not because Christianity has lost its flavor. It's not because the Word of God is no longer applicable. It's not because Jesus Christ can no longer solve the world's problems. It's because we have created a perspective of what we think God should be like. And now as we walk around and our lives or our expectations aren't met, we are seeing things with clouded vision instead of seeing things how God wants them to be seen. Because you see, suffering and crisis shouldn't lead us to questioning God, they should lead us to God. But the problem is, when we begin to doubt, doubt begins to cause questions and insecurity. And when we doubt God, we don't run to God. When you're in a moment of pain, when you're in a moment of crisis, when you're in a moment of suffering, you're not going to run to somebody you're not sure about. You're going to run to that family member, to that friend, that person that's been with you through thick and thin, that no matter what you say or no matter what you do or no matter what's going on in your life, you know they're going to be there for you. But when we begin to doubt God, what happens is we stop running to God and we start running from God. And you see so many people walking away from their faith in God through Jesus Christ because of this perspective. Because of unanswered questions, because of hard things that have happened. And yes, they're hard. Yes, they don't make sense. Yes, we wonder, God, why? But ultimately, God says, I have an answer. I have the answer. The answer is Jesus. And crisis and suffering and chaos in your life should not draw you away from God, but it should lead you to God. Because we say, God, I don't understand it. God, I don't see it. God, my heart is broken and I have pain and it is real, but I'm not going to shift the blame because wrong perspective shifts the blame to somebody who is not. I remember when I was in college, I was going through a breakdown. Everybody got a job. When I was in Bible college, I moved to Oklahoma. Everybody had a job. I didn't have a job. I was looking for a job every day of the week for about 2 months. I was looking for a job. Everybody else was working and I wasn't working. And finally I popped. And I remember when I popped, I had a big breakdown and everybody was around. And I remember my good friend now, he's over in the youth auditorium, Pastor Joe. I looked at him and I just started yelling at him and I started going after him and I started saying, everything that I'm mad about is his fault. And he's just looking at me like, what did I do? Because you see, a wrong perspective will shift the blame onto somebody else. And what we begin to do is we begin to shift the blame on God when it's not God to blame. God did not create a world. And His desire and His will and His thought process and what He wanted. He did not create a world full of calamity and chaos. He created Adam and Eve who were oblivious to sin, but yet through man's own decision, handed over the authority of the earth, the dominion of earth to the devil. And therefore we live in a fallen world, a world that is acceptable, that there are seed time and harvest, that there are seasons, a time for laughing and a time for crying, a time for planting and a time for sowing, a time for living and a time for dying. Because this is an imperfect world. But God had a plan. God had a plan all along for humanity. And that plan was Jesus. You see, perspective points us to Jesus. Our mission in life is to not look at what God is not doing, but to see what God has already done. That He gave us Jesus. And Jesus is not somebody that doesn't understand you and I. In the prophecy of Jesus for the Christmas season, in the book of Isaiah, in the 53rd chapter, as they're prophesying about the Messiah to come, the Bible tells us in Isaiah 53, I'll put it up on the overhead, it says that he was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief. And when he hid, as it were, we hid, as it were, our faces from him, and he was despised, and we did not esteem him. Look what verse number 4 says. Surely he has borne our griefs, he has carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God and afflicted. You see, God can relate because of Jesus Christ. He knows your pain. He knows the sufferings of humanity, the travesties and the victims around the world that are in horrific situation. God knows them. Have you ever sinned or messed up in your life? Has anybody ever made a mistake? Amen. Have you ever felt the condemnation and the guilt and the burden of that sin that you've carried around, beating yourself up? Why did I do this? I knew better. It was a terrible decision, and all of a sudden you're just beating yourself up. Can you imagine Jesus Christ on the cross of Calvary, bearing every sin and every shame and every humiliation and every burden that every man, woman, and child on the earth who lived and who will live on earth will have? I mean, I've had some humdinger mistakes in my life. I've had some burdens and some things that have weighed me down, that have really brought me down. Can you imagine Jesus Christ bearing not just that one for every person on earth, that one for all of my life and every person that ever lived and every person that will ever live, all at one moment? Think about that for a moment. And we ask God, where are you? God says, I am the same place I was when I watched Jesus endure suffering and shame. I was the same place, a man of sorrows, acquainted with our grief. See, God knows your pain. God knows your heart, your heartaches. He knows what's going on. He knows the sufferings in your life. But he says, listen, child, I want you to know that there is an answer for you, and the answer is Jesus. Because as we preachers like to say, Jesus is everything we will ever need in life. And when we put our culture comforts ahead of our life's purpose, we will have a shifted perspective in life. When we begin to see, I need fulfillment by likes of people, I need fulfillment by safety and security, my needs in my life because of my culture are safety and security and a safe place to be, all of a sudden we put that above everything else, and our perspective begins to change when God himself says, listen, I am acquainted with grief, I am acquainted with sorrows. And nowhere in the Bible does it promise us a utopian life here on earth. As a matter of fact, throughout the course of the Bible, Old and New Testament, God gives us warning signs that we will face suffering on the earth because it's an imperfect world, because there's sin in humanity, because humanity has a predisposed disposition to sin and to not, to love and to faith and to hope. And legislating it and ruling it will not solve the problem. Why? Because it's on the inside of us. But God says, I have the answer. Why? Because the answer is not legislation. The answer is not government. The answer is not rules. The answer is not over here. The answer is not over there. The answer is not in a man. The answer is not in a book. The answer is not in some great philosophy. The answer is in Jesus Christ, because Jesus is the only one that can take us in our present condition of suffering and of pain, of heartache, of sin and shame and condemnation. Jesus is the only one that can take us and physically change the inside of us in our hearts to say we are no longer predisposed to a sin nature, but now we are predisposed to grace through Jesus Christ. Grace and life through Jesus we have. Because suffering in the Bible, as we read it, suffering doesn't show us and reveal to us. It doesn't emphasize on deliverance. It doesn't emphasize on the problem. Suffering, as we read it in the Bible, emphasizes God and His presence in the midst of suffering. When we read the Psalms, David in Psalm 22, when he's preaching a messianic psalm that Jesus himself on the cross quotes in Psalm 22, verse 1, he says, my God, why have you forsaken me? And he's focusing on the issue, but verse number 3, he comes back and he says, but you are holy, and you are just, and you will be there in my life because his presence is always there in the midst of suffering. The emphasis on suffering in the Bible and in our life is not on God's deliverance, because if we want to see God's deliverance, Paul the apostle lost his head. Peter was nailed to a cross. James was pushed off a building in Jerusalem. But yet despite all of these things, they pressed on in their relationship with God, and they had a perspective that it wasn't about my present circumstances. The Bible tells us that Paul is the Job of the New Testament, is what people call Paul, who experienced amazing afflictions. And Paul was talking about it in 2 Corinthians, the first chapter. Paul says, I have such problems right now in my life. There was some persecution for us, he says, in Asia, to the point where I didn't think I was going to live. I didn't think I could make it through this. And he goes on and he says, but grace be to God who delivered us, who will deliver us, and who will continue to deliver us. And in 4 chapters later, Paul the apostle says, this light affliction that we have is for a moment. The same affliction that he was talking about that he didn't even think he could make it through, now he begins to call it light affliction. Why? Because he realizes and he recognizes that his perspective, it's not about me, it's about God. See, the problem is that we've created in our society, in our culture, because we want to focus on the utopia of Christianity, we've created this idea of a concierge God. I remember I got the opportunity to stay at a Ritz-Carlton. Oh my gosh, living it up. I got the opportunity to stay at a Ritz-Carlton, and my wife and I, we were in San Francisco, and we stayed at the Ritz-Carlton, and we wanted to go out on the town. We wanted to go see San Francisco. So we went to the concierge, and we said, what's a great place to eat dinner at that night? Concierge says, you know what? I got a great place. It's on the water, beautiful view. And they called up, and they says, you know what? The restaurant is booked. So they called up, and they says, listen, hey, this is so-and-so from the Ritz. I got a client over here that wants to come to dinner. And even though you've got booked reservations, can they come? And because they were the Ritz-Carlton concierge, the restaurant made a way for us to get in. Now, we got to the restaurant, we saw the prices on the menu, and said, we think we'll go somewhere else. But you see, we have this idea of a concierge God, that God is here. His purpose in life is to give us everything that we ask of Him, everything that we desire of Him, that His sole purpose in His existence in life is to make us happy. You see, God is sovereign. There's nobody before God. There's nobody after God. There's nobody above God. And God's sole purpose is not to make you and I happy. It's the other way around. That's the perspective problem, is that we begin to think that God is here for me. No, we are here for God. The very reason of our existence here on earth is to glorify God. As a matter of fact, the Westminster Catechism in England asked the question, what is man's end? The reply is to know God and to live in His glory all of our days. You see, the very purpose of our existence is not so that God would make us happy, make us feel good, do everything we need and everything we ask and everything we wish. Because when we have that perspective, we put on the blinders of life and we begin to see God, not how God is, we begin to see how God is, how we think God is. And then all of a sudden when we ask for something and it doesn't come, when we believe for something and it doesn't happen, when all of a sudden we endure suffering and pain and we don't seem like, God, where are you in this moment? It's because we are seeing through a dim and distorted perspective of who God is. You see, life is not about what God can do for me. It's about what I can do for God. Amen. My purpose here on earth is to glorify God and to know Him intimately. And if nothing else in my life happens with the exemption of knowing Jesus as my personal Lord and Savior, that, my friends, is enough for a quality life. Amen. Amen. Because we take our creature comforts and we take our culture comforts and we say, you know what, I want a nice house, I want prosperity, I want money, I want a good bank account, I want my health, I want my safety, I want my security, I want good weather all the time, I want it to be sunny when it's raining and I want it to rain when it's sunny. And when it doesn't happen, we begin to ask God, why? Why? Why aren't you doing this? When you see God's looking at us saying, listen, my purpose is not for you, I'm God. I created everything. I made the world that you're living in, the universe, the stars that you haven't even discovered yet. I know them by name. He says, the purpose is not for me to do everything for you. The purpose is for you to know me. And I have given you the solution. And his name is Jesus. And it's because of Jesus that I can live my life's purpose to know God intimately through the course of my life. And if nothing else, my life is fulfilled and great and grand and full of everything else, because Jesus is all that I ever need in life. Amen. It's a perspective problem. It's a perspective problem. Suffering doesn't focus on what God isn't doing. It focuses on what God is doing. It leads us to, it shows us the purpose of our lives. We begin to say, God, why don't you do something? And God responds to us, I did, child. Yeah. And the solution for you and I is to always look to Jesus Christ. Amen. You see, stories like Steve Jobs, stories like many of the other celebrities, many of the other people around the world, many of the other atheists that are arguing against the very question that we ask in times of crisis, they can be avoided because what happens is we look to God and we miss Jesus. And we begin to see this deity, this concierge in the sky that's here for me. But when we realize that God sent Jesus, now my eyes are fixed and focused upon Jesus. And Jesus, through the grace of God, through the grace of Jesus Christ, is everything I need. Then all of a sudden my life is fulfilled and my life is full. Because in times of suffering, Jesus Christ is there. And when Jesus Christ is in our suffering and in our presence, in the presence of our suffering, his grace is there also. His grace, God's sovereign divine ability to get the job done on our behalf when I can't do it. His grace to get you through the trials and the tribulations that don't seem like you're going to make it. To survive the situations that you don't think you're going to survive. To go one more day when you don't think you can make it another day. The grace of God is there to carry you through because of Jesus Christ. Why? Because suffering, it's not emphasis in the Bible. It's not on the deliverance. It's not on the pain. Suffering is always there and emphasizing on God's presence. You see, God is always there through Jesus Christ in your life. In the midst of the deepest and darkest moments of you and of my life, Jesus is there with us. And when Jesus is with us, the grace of God is there. The grace to get us through, the grace to see us through, the grace to say what needs to be said, the grace to look to God and say, God, I don't understand. God, I'm in pain. God, I'm crying out. God, why could you let this happen? But you know what? I don't even know why, God. I don't even want to know why. That's for you to know and for me to get to know you more. And the grace of Jesus Christ comes and it sustains us and it carries us and it lifts us up in our times of need so that we can be who God has called us to be. So that when we see statistics like Christianity in America, we don't have to see a decline because of a shifted perspective, because of a tweaked or distorted view of what God is. No, now we begin to realize, you know what? Life ultimately isn't about what God will do for me. My life is all about what I will do for God. God, why aren't you doing something? God says, I did. I sent Jesus, and now he's on the inside of you. And because he's on the inside of you, you live and you operate in faith, hope, and love. And the greatest of these is love, the Bible says. And now all of a sudden the world begins to change. Why? Because the grace of God is there to sustain us in our deepest and darkest times of need. 2 Corinthians in the 12th chapter. Paul the Apostle. He's talking about a thorn in the flesh. He's talking about his sufferings in verse number 11. He says, man, let me just tell you what I have been going through. Talks about stonings. He talks about afflictions. He talks about being beat. He talks about having to been lowered out of a wall on the chase. He talks about all these different things. And all of a sudden he says, I have a revelation. And because I have a revelation, I have a thorn in my side that I wouldn't get puffed up and I wouldn't think life is all about me. And he says, I asked God 3 times in my life to remove this thorn, this irritation, this hardship in my life. And the response that Jesus Christ, words of Christ in red in your Bible, Jesus himself speaks to Paul and he says, my grace is sufficient for you. My strength is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, most gladly, I'll rather boast in my infirmities. I had them, I asked if they would, but they missed it. Therefore, the most important thing right there in today, Paul says, Jesus Christ spoke to me, and he says, therefore, because of what Jesus Christ just said, when I'm going through a hardship, I'll boast. In my infirmities, I'll be glad, like Peter and James also say. I'll rejoice going through hardships and tribulations. Why? Because I know that Jesus Christ is present in my life right now. That his grace to carry me through, his grace to get me through, his grace to put one foot in front of the next in my life, to endure, to survive, and to thrive, and to be blessed, and to know him intimately as each day goes by, to glorify God, and to know him eternally as this life comes to an end. The grace that will see me through these is the grace that will propel me through life. Because where Jesus Christ is in the midst of suffering, his grace is also there in the midst of suffering. So as the world cries, God, why? We begin to cry, God has through Jesus. And I'm not afraid of somebody shaming me for saying, I'll pray for you, for thinking of you. And if the world wants to have, if the Western culture wants to remove God from society and live in a distorted perspective, then that's what they're going to do. But I'm going to do the best I can in my life to live my life with the perspective of what God says about me and not what I think about God. See, Paul the Apostle was living in a time of great tribulation. AD 70, in the middle of Paul the Apostle's life, Rome destroyed Jerusalem because of a Jewish rebellion. The Jewish historian Josephus writes about the siege of Jerusalem, saying that the Roman legionaries literally had to scramble over bodies of victims, men, women, and child, in the city of Jerusalem to continue their siege. That the people that were killed outnumbered the people that were attacking. And through the midst of this, through every Jew, through every Christian being dispersed and spread abroad around the world, through this great time of persecution, Paul continued to preach the gospel. James continued to preach the gospel. The church in Antioch grew to the hundreds of thousands. The church in Ephesus grew. The church in Corinth grew. The church in Rome grew. The church spread to Europe. It spread to Spain. It spread to Syria and Iraq and Iran. It spread to Africa. It went all the way to India. Through times of persecution and hardship and suffering, the church grew despite the pain. Why? Because they had a perspective that my life was not about me. My life was all about God. You know that the church in China right now is having an Acts revival, the Book of Acts revival. They're seeing healings, they're seeing revival, they're seeing gifts of the Spirit, they're seeing all sorts of different things. Tens of thousands of people every day are coming to the kingdom of God despite the horrific persecutions that are happening in the church of China, despite tortures and imprisonment. Estimations and research show that in China, there are more than 100 million Christians in the underground church of China, which means there are more Christians in China today than there are in the United States of America. And they say that by 2025, remember that same statistic? 25% of China will be Christian. Right now, it's at 10%, doubling. So while America is declining, while China is going through persecution, they're growing. Because of perspective. Because we're missing the boat. Because our life is all about us and our comforts and what we think we should have. People like Steve Jobs who were gifts to the world. People like the celebrities of Hollywood with talents and abilities. People down the street from you and from me, people in our families are missing out because we're so wrapped up in our perspective that we want to see God how we think God should be. When in the worst places in the world, places like North Korea, places like China, places like Egypt and the Middle East, Christians are growing in number daily. Despite suffering, because perspective shows my life's not about me. My life's about God. And when my life's about God, when I have Jesus, it doesn't matter if I have safety. It doesn't matter if I have security. It doesn't matter if I have a warm shelter, a roof, or a jacket over my head. All that matters in my life is that I have Jesus. Because I have the privilege of living a fulfilled life. The reason I was created to glorify God and to know Him, now all of a sudden everything else fades away because my perspective is aligned on God and everything else becomes secondary to Jesus Christ. I believe the statistics of America and of the Western church don't have to be so. But it's going to take people like you and me, people around the United States and around the world to say, you know what? I'm not going to ask God why when I don't know and I won't know. That's for God to know. I'm going to ask God, what? What do you want me to do? What do you need me to do? What can I do to get out of my comfort zone? To get out of my life? To get out of my perspective? God, what can I do to glorify your name? Because as we saw in the first century churches, we see in the churches of persecuted regions, the more they suffer, the more they grow. But it seems like the churches of the Western culture, the more we're blessed, the more we decline. Could it be that we're missing the boat? You see, no matter what happens in your life, through the hardest and the worst times, Jesus is always there. And where Jesus is, His grace is there. And when you've got the grace of God, Bible says in Romans that where sin abounds, grace abounds more. When human nature abounds, God's grace overshadows everything else. That we are no longer predisposed to who we once were. Now we are destined for glory, for God, because of the grace of Jesus Christ. Why? Because you don't have to go through life thinking you're alone. Because no matter where you are, no matter what you're going through, God is there. Christmas season, talking about this right there on the wall. Bible says Emmanuel, God with us. Matthew, in the first chapters, the angels are talking to Mary. They're talking to Joseph. They say, you'll conceive and you'll be with child and you'll bear a son. And they shall call his name Emmanuel. What's in a name? Everything's in a name. The very name of Jesus Christ is God with us. The hope for our lives is that Jesus Christ is with us everywhere we go. In the darkest and the greatest times of our life, Jesus is there. And when Jesus is there, His grace overshadows everything else. And you can make it through crisis, through suffering, through hardship. You can do it. You can make it. You can survive because of Jesus Christ. But it takes us removing the perspective of what we think we know about God. And begin to put on the eyesight and the glasses of what God says, I want you to know about me. That's when this world will change. It's not laws. It's not politicians. It's not regulations. It's Jesus. And we cannot afford to miss the boat any longer. Did you guys get something out of the Word of God tonight? I've gone late, as I always do. I'm incapable of preaching on time. I just have too much inside of me. Got to work on that. Before we leave today, I just want to take a quick moment. There are those of you in this place that maybe you've been living a life of perspective. Maybe it's the wrong perspective. You've been thinking about your relationship with God. I don't want to make light, and I don't want to take advantage of the situation in a negative light. But as we saw, life is fragile. It's unpredictable and it's short. We can't live in the past. We don't know what the future holds. All we have is right now. You see, the Bible tells us that nobody knows what tomorrow holds. And we'd be foolish to assume that we have yet another day here on earth. Today, I want to give you the opportunity right now, just the next couple of minutes, just take a moment to look at your life, to ask you the question, if you were to die today, would you go to heaven or would you go to hell? You see, that says a lot about your position with God. That says a lot about your perspective of God. And how you answer that question has a lot to say about your position. And today I want to talk to you about that. So often our perspective, when I talk to people, when I hear from people, our perspective is misaligned. Perspective such as, I think I'm going to go to heaven and I hope I'm going to go to heaven. Perspective such as, you know, I'm a good person. I do good things. I give to charitable organizations and good people go to heaven. Perspective such as, I sit in church services. Therefore, that means that everything's good in my life. But did you know that nowhere in the Bible Nowhere in God's holy word does it say that you can think, that you can hope, or you can wish. Nowhere in God's word does it say that because you're a good person. Nowhere does it say that because you're a church attendee, a member of a church, that you give in the offering bucket as it goes by. Nowhere do you see in the Word of God that you give yourself a label of Christian. I'm not a Buddhist or a Hindu or a Muslim or anything else. I always thought that that meant that by classification, I was going to go to heaven. You'll not find that in God's Word. Why? Because that's all misaligned perspective. But Jesus said, I came to show the world as a light the way. He says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. He says, no one will go to the Father except through me. You see, there's no other way for you and I to be in right standing with God. There's no other answer to the condition of humanity, not philosophy, not goodwill, not good deeds, not this religion or that philosophical thought. You see, the only answer to humanity is Jesus. And it comes by accepting Jesus into our heart, into our life, as our Lord and Savior, to surrender our lives to the fulfillment of God's purpose, to say, it's not about me, it's about what I can do for God, because God saved me from my sin. See, Jesus was talking to a man by the name of Nicodemus, and Nicodemus was a good man, a religious man, a man who served God. He memorized scripture, he gave to the poor, he did all the right things. Jesus says to Nicodemus, Nicodemus, in order to see the kingdom of God, he says, you must be born again. What does that mean, born again? Hollywood society has made that to be a culture, especially in the recent weeks and in light of the recent events. But born again isn't what society makes it out to be, weirdo, crazy, out of control Christianity. Born again, from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, has always meant the same thing. It means that you've given your heart, you've given your life to Jesus Christ. See, the Bible says that when you give your life to Jesus, all of a sudden something happens. You've got Jesus in your life and you are a new creation. You're no longer who you once were. You're no longer bound to the things that you once were. You're no longer predisposed to the things that you were once were. Why? Because your perspective changes, and now you're going for Jesus with all of your heart and with all of your life. See, God didn't send his only begotten son, Jesus Christ, to die on a cross that we might have a good thought about him, that we might have a decent perspective of him, that we might have knowledge of who he is or what he did. You see, God sent Jesus Christ to die on a cross to bear our sin, yours and my sin or my shame, so that we could know him intimately. And that's why God says, listen, I want all of your life. I want all of your heart. I don't want just a little bit of you. I don't want a token prayer. I don't want a little thought over here. I don't want a little thought over there. He says, I want everything, because that's the only answer to the problems of your life. The book of Revelation, Jesus is speaking to his church, and he says, listen, when I come back, I'd rather find that you're hot. I'd rather find that you're cold. He says, because if you're lukewarm, he says, I'll vomit you. And what's he saying? He's saying, listen, I want you. You're worth it. I paid a price for you on the cross. And he says, in return, I want you to come and follow after me, to live the purpose and the destiny of your life, to know me intimately every day, greater and greater, and to have my grace and my peace and my life in your life here on earth, and to spend eternity with me in paradise. And it doesn't come any other way but except through Jesus Christ. Jesus says these words. He says that if you confess him before men, he'll confess you before his Father. He says, but if you deny him, he'll deny you. Today, I want to give you the opportunity. I'm going to count to three. I'll go one, two, and on the count of three, I'll go three, and I'll smack my hands together real loud. Bang, just like that. And when I do, I'm going to ask you to do something real bold. I'm going to ask you to pop your hand up. You see, what you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, you know what? I'm going to make the decision today. I want to follow Jesus. I want to give my life to Jesus. Pastor Luke, what you were talking about today with perspective, you know what? If I look at my life and I'm honest, I've been looking at life through the wrong perspective, and I'm tired of it. I'm tired of the frustration. I'm tired of the pain. I'm tired of the anguish. I'm tired of the emptiness of looking at life through the wrong perspective. And today, I want to make the decision to go after God with the right perspective in my life. I'm a man. I'll see your hand. I'll acknowledge it. You can put it right back down. But if I raise my hand, I'm going to be embarrassed. No, I'm not going to embarrass you. That's not what I'm here. I'm here to build you, to support you, to encourage you, to do whatever I can to see you through life in God's plan, in God's will. And it starts today by making that decision. Who should raise your hands if you're in this place today? If you've never given your heart, you've never given your life to Jesus Christ, if that's you in just a moment, get ready. Pop your hand up. I'll see you in just a moment. If you're not sure, maybe you did this as a child. Maybe you did this in youth group or elementary school. You went to a crusade once before and you prayed that prayer, but you've never really felt that difference, or you've been living a life in the wrong perspective all along. Listen, today, don't walk out of this place without making sure of your eternal destiny with God right here, right now, and accepting the life of Jesus Christ and the fulfillment in your heart and in your life right here and right now. If you've been living lukewarm, doing your own thing instead of God's thing, having that doubt like we talked about, instead of running to God, you've been running from God because of all these different things. It's time for you to say, you know what? I'm going to have my faith in Jesus Christ. I'm going to give him my heart. I'm going to give him my life today. And I'm going to trust that he's going to take me through with his grace and his leadership through all the trials and storms of my life. If that's you in this place today, in just a moment, I want you to pop your hand up and raise it. I'll see it. You guys in the family rooms, I can see you. If you're at home watching on the television, there's a little button. If you minimize the viewer, if you just don't make it full screen, there's a little blue button that says, no God. Click on that. Somebody will pray with you right there on the screen. You've had doctors and dentist appointments today. It's a divine appointment. You're here for this reason today. It's time for you to surrender your life, to give your life to Jesus Christ, and to live the purpose that you have. To have grace through the times of suffering and through the times of need, to endure, to get through it. Because Paul says, therefore, I'd rather boast in my infirmities. I'd rather rejoice in the hardships of my life, because now I know that Jesus Christ is in operation in my life. And if I've got Jesus for me, like the Bible tells me in Romans, then nothing else can be against me. It doesn't matter. Perspective in life. And it's time for you to start living life right here, right now. So I'm going to count to three. And when I do, if that's you, pop your hand up. I'll see your hand. I'll acknowledge it. You can put it right back down. Whether you're in the front row, the back row, side to side, wherever you're at, this is your moment. This is your time. Today is the day of your salvation. It's time for us to do this together. You ready? I'm going to count to three. And when I do, pop your hand up. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it. You can put it right back down. You ready? Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands in this place today. Say, I want to give my heart. I want to give my life. One, two, three. I got you guys right there. Three wise people. Don't clap yet. Don't. Four, I see you right over there. Five, I got you right over there. Five wise people. You say, I wonder if I should. Yes, you should. The Spirit of God speaking to you, say, man, I just got this feeling on the inside. Come on, it's time for you to respond to God. Say, the ushers are pointing to me. I see you right over there. Number six, I got you right over there. Six wise people, say, man, I wonder if I should. Yes, come on, I don't want you to miss out on this opportunity. It's too good for you. Six wise people, I see you right over there, my man. Number seven, God bless you. Where are you at in this house? You say, you know what, number eight, number nine, number 10, where are you at? You say, come on, I just don't know. It's time for you to accept life. To open up your eyes to the perspective of God in your life. And I don't want to coerce you, but I want to tell you the truth like it is and not water it down. Anybody else in this place? Seven wise people. Anybody else in this place today? Well, let's give God a great big praise for seven wise people. That's great. So good. Here's what we're going to do. I've kept you so late. Probably like the latest I've ever done, and I'm so sorry for that. I'm going to let you go in just a minute, but I'm asking you to do me one more favor. In support of those who've raised your hands, listen, you don't get saved by raising your hand. You get saved by inviting, by surrendering your life to Jesus Christ. And we're going to do that together. What you're doing is you're saying, I'm making a decision. Listen, let's talk logic. You know this. Every decision requires action. Otherwise, nothing happens. So today, we're going to decide together. We're going to act on this together. We're going to do this together. I want to pray with you. I'm going to lead you in a prayer. I'm going to give you some free information. We're going to help set you off on the right path. So in just a moment, we're all going to stand. And my friend over here, Elijah, he's going to sing a song. And as we stand and sing a song, I want you to grab your coat, your sweater, your purse, your Bible, a friend if you need a friend. If you raise your hand, I want you to get out of your seat, get out of your chair, get into the aisle, and come meet me right here at this altar, because I want to change destinies with you right here, right now. Let's go forward together in what God has in store for you. So let's all stand together. If you raise your hand, or you should have raised your hand, come on, come on. Get out of your seat, get out of your chair. Come meet me right here. Let's change destinies right now. You come. Come on. You can come. Wherever you're at, if that's you in this place, you come, come on, come on. Yep, wherever you're at, come on, if that's you. Yeah, you can come, it's not too late, come on. This is your moment. Well, praise God. Hey guys, look it, you came. And somebody needs to tell you something, all right? Somebody needs to tell you, good job. Because you're making the smartest decision you could possibly make. To choose life, to choose destiny and fulfillment. I mean, good job. Great job. Here's what I want to do. I want to do something with you. I want to introduce a friend of mine to you. See this guy right over here? His name's Pastor Joel. I said, well, we're going to pray with you. He's going to do a couple things. He's going to take you guys right over there. Nothing weird goes on, okay? He's going to do what I said. He's going to pray with you to accept Jesus into your heart, into your life. You're going to surrender. Say, God, I accept you in my life. Second thing he's going to do is we don't want you to leave here empty-handed. We want you to get hooked up, okay? So we're going to give you some free information, some real easy-to-read literature to just say, you know what? I gave my heart to Jesus. What do I do now? We're going to help set you off in the right direction. Third thing he's going to do is he's going to give you a friend, invite you back to church to connect you with somebody. They'll meet you in our cafe, get you a soda, a cup of coffee, something like that. We even got them for the kids and the youth to meet with you, a friend, a counselor, a coach, somebody that will help build you up for just a couple of weeks to teach you some things about the Word of God, to get you strong in the ways of God so that you don't go back to the life that you're walking away from, but you go forward in everything that God has for you and all the blessings that God has for you. So if you guys would just turn to your left, my right, go right over there with my buddy, Pastor Joel. Amen. Amen. God is good.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son, and that you sent him for me, and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you. Bye-bye.